पटावाड़ा आप आई गए तुम याद कर इंतला कौस्तु
गुड आफ्टरनून सर, वेलकम डॉक्टर वी के प्रजापति सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून,
गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीवन। नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अवर थर्ड सेशन फॉर टुडे। नाउ टुडे वी हैव अ एमिनेंट स्पीकर डॉक्टर वी के प्रजापति सर। इट्स माय ग्रेट प्लेजर टू इंट्रोड्यूस अवर expert for this session here. I give a brief introduction of Dr. V.K. Prajapati sir. He have completed BE from VVP Rajkot, ME completed from LDC Ahmedabad, also PhD completed from SVNIT Surat. He had publications more than 10 papers in reputed journals as well as reputed international conferences like PyCon, NPSC, IndieCon, and also he have published papers in international journals like IET, elsewhere, Taylor and Francis, Willey. He has more than 15 years experience in this study, in this GEC Government Engineering College, as well as Government Polytechnic. His area of interest are power system operation and control, renewable energy, microgrid optimizations, distributed generation, as well as energy optimization techniques. So with this enriched experience and exposure of Dr. V.K. Prajapati sir, I would like to invite him to start this session. Now it's over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor B.D. Patel, for nice introduction. Am I properly audible?
Yes, sir. You audible, and the sharing is also visible. PPT is visible now.
Okay. Again, good afternoon to all participants. So today we will discuss one important point, that is the quantitative impact of PEVs on power system with renewable resources. As we know that right now many researchers and scientists are trying to reduce the carbon emissions, because there are lots of disadvantages of the carbon emissions that will affect the climate change on the earth, and that will also affect the adversely affect the our atmosphere and humankind. So particularly being as a power system engineers, how can we reduce that particular carbon emissions? So there are two ways. So one way is that we can reduce the our conventional, that is the thermal generation, we can reduce thermal generations, and at the same time we can increase the our renewable resources. As we know that the renewable resources are very clean in nature, and the operating charges are also very comparatively very less comparative to the conventional thermal power generations. And the other point is that if we use PEVs, plug-in electrical vehicles, or electrical vehicles, so definitely it will reduce the carbon emissions, because nowadays majority vehicles are run by the fuels like diesel or petrol that emits the carbon in atmosphere. Definitely it will create a pollution, and again it will be dangerous to our atmosphere and humankind. So now, what is the role of what is the impact of the plug-in electric vehicle as well as renewable resources, particularly in power system operations? So today we'll see the quantitative impact. Quantitative impact means what? We will see the various cases, means without PEVs and with number of PEVs. So what is the impact of PEVs on the power system operations? And here we will do this analysis or study this analysis with certain assumptions. I will give you some certain assumptions later on, but we will discuss in later on detail which are the assumptions. But the thing is that these renewable resources are very uncertain in nature, because you cannot predict the guaranteed output at particular location or at particular time. So definitely these renewable resources are uncertain in nature, and that is why we have to do some modeling, uncertainty modeling of renewable resources. Similarly, the plug-in electrical vehicle, you cannot guarantee that at particular time this much vehicle will come to for charging purpose, and so the load on the due to the plug-in electrical vehicle, you cannot perfectly estimate. Yes, based on some historical data you can estimate, but perfectly you cannot accurately estimate that this much of vehicle coming for charging purpose and this much amount of load will on the power systems. So this is the brief idea about the my talk. So let's see further.
Sir, can you share the full screen for the PPT?
I think I have saved this full screen because it is a PDF copy.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Is it visible or not visible?
It's visible, sir, but some of the area is not means fully not utilized. That's why.
One minute, please. Wait.
After the sharing, you may make the F5 buttons for full screen.
Yes, yes, but actually it's a PDF copy. I think it's a...
Yes, now it's visible now, sir.
It's visible.
Yes, it's nice to see all the part.
Okay. So this is the outline of my presentations. First is introductions. Second thing is uncertainty modeling. Third one is objective functions and constraints. Fourth one is scenario reduction techniques. Fifth one is algorithm. Sixth one is test system and data. Seventh one is result analysis. Eighth one is references. So we will go in this manner. So what is the outcome? So, or what will be the major outcome of this our studies? So first one is the quantifying impact of number of PEVs on generation cost, rescheduling cost, and PEV charging cost. See, here we study three different cost. First is generation cost. This generation cost is related to the thermal conventional generations. Second one is rescheduling cost. Why this rescheduling cost? Because when we purchase any power after market clearing process, as you know that power is traded, or energy is traded in the energy market. So the main purpose of this trading is to get the cheapest power or the power at the cheapest rate. At that time, we have not considered the network constraint. So when actually after getting this power, after market clearing process, when we run the load flow, the sum of the line get congested or the sum of the parameters of the power systems may deviate from its specified limits. So the independent system operator is the entity which takes care of the operation of the power system, means it has to take care of the various parameters and it has to be within limits. So whenever this limit violates it, so ISO will ask the GENCOs to reschedule their generations, and that, and for that ISO has to pay the additional cost, that is called the rescheduling cost. And another cost is PEV charging cost, means the vehicle owner has to pay for charging cost, as a charging cost. In this analysis, we have considered the variable load. As we know that the load on the, our system is not fixed. The load on the system during the morning, during the evening, and during the afternoon is varying. Okay. And we have also considered the uncertainty natures of wind, solar, and PEVs. As I already told you that we cannot predict the guaranteed output. Yes, we can estimate, but there is an error in the estimates. So that we will discuss in the uncertainty modeling sections. The third thing is the, as we know that there are two kind of operations, V2G and G2V, means vehicle to grid and grid to vehicle mode operations. And by coordinating these two vehicle to grid and grid to vehicle operations of the PEVs, we will reduce the generation cost and total power generation as well as loss per day. We will see in detail how can we reduce this generation cost and power generation and loss for a day. And the last one is here, PEV aggregator is one entity And this entity can be treated as a small storage unit, and this small storage unit can supply the grid during the peak hours. So these things that we will also see in our analysis. So these are the our major outcome of the, our presentations. Introductions. As I told you that in recent years, researchers are more focusing in reducing the environmental pollutions by decreasing the carbon emissions. And that is why, and that can be attained by the usage of renewable resources and plug-in electrical vehicle. But the disadvantage or the demerits of these renewable resources is that these RES or PEPs insert the uncertainties in the power system, and which definitely affects the reliable operation of the power systems. Now, as we know that the demand on the power system day by day increasing, or the load growth is increasing, is penetration of RES is also increasing day by day, and the penetration of PEV is also increasing. And the third, the most important thing is that our transmission line, the carrying capacity, power carrying capacity is fixed. So due to this load growth, penetration of PEVs and uncertainty of the RES, there is a very, very much possibilities of congestion in the transmission line. So we have to also remove these congestions due to these parameters. So who will remove these congestions? Who will take care of these congestions? So the ISO is the responsible. ISO means independent system operator. And this is independent system operations is responsible for economic and congestion free operation of network. And that is why the quantifying impact of PEVs charging and uncertain output of RES make challenges task for ISO to manage the congestion free operation of power systems. See, nowadays ISO has a challenging task. Why is it challenging? Because the load on the demand is increasing day by day, penetration of RES increasing, that is also uncertain, plug-in electrical vehicle day by day increasing, this is also uncertain, and that is why the congestion free operation and economic operations is challenging task for the ISO, and that is why this study is very important for the ISO. See, this is the schematic representation of our system that we have considered. In this you can see that a generation is there. There are two types of generation we have considered. One is the conventional generator, that is the thermal generations. Another is the renewable energy sources. Similarly, on the other parts, load is there, including the PV charging stations. So there are two type of flow is there. ISO is there, that is the independent system operators. And transmission network, that is the power grid. So there are two types of flow is there. One is called energy flow, another is called information flows. So ISO always take care of these energy flows, information flows, and it also displays the cost information. That is the GenCos cost, DISCOM costs. Okay. And ISO will manage this congestion, as well as it will manage the all the parameters of the power system. Whether it is a violate the limits, if it is violates, then definitely it will give some corrective actions. It will instruct the GenCos, DISCOs or TransCos to give some corrective measures and try to parameters within the limits. So So this is our schematic representations of our system under studies. Now uncertainty modeling. So here we will see the uncertainty modeling of wind power generation, solar power generations, and plug-in electrical vehicle aggregator. As we know that wind power generation depends on the wind speed, solar power generation depends on the solar irradiation level at particular location or particular sites, and similarly the plug-in electrical vehicle modeling depends upon the three parameters, that is the arrival time of the plug-in electrical vehicles for the charging, departure time, and initial SOC, means state of charge level of the battery of the EV. You cannot predict these three things: arrival time of the PEV, departure time is after fully being charged, at which time it will depart, and what is the initial SOC of the PEV, means whether it is a 50%, 20%, 30%, or totally discharge, battery is totally discharge of PEV. So you cannot predict. So that is uncertain things. These three things of the PEVs are always uncertain: arrival time, departure time, and initial SOC, or we can say the residual SOC. Residual means how much battery is residual power, that is called residual SOC. So we will see some certain equations regarding this uncertainty modeling of this wind power, solar power, and plug-in electrical vehicle aggregator. So let's start that. First, the wind power generation. As you know that the output power of the wind unit is uncertain due to the intermittent nature of the wind speed over a day. The wind speed over a day is also varying from morning to evening, even night also. So how can we forecast that wind speed? So for that, a probability density functions is used. See, there are various type of probability density functions available in literature. I will not say go in detail of the types of the probability density functions, but the probability density function means it gives the probability of the particular variable, or we can say that in this case wind speed. So which probability density function it follows, that we have to study. So according to the literature, wind speed follows the Rayleigh PDF, means Rayleigh probability density function, and that is given by the equation number 1. So in this equation, V is the wind speed and K is the scale index. Okay, so equation number 1 indicates the Rayleigh PDF and is means the probability of the wind speed. So you can find out the probability of wind speed by using the equation number 1. Now, as we know that we can have some historical data of the wind speed. So based on this historical data, we can find out the average of the wind speed and standard deviation of the wind speed. If you know of average of the wind speed and standard deviation of the wind speed for a particular location based on the historical data, and definitely the historical data is available from the various sites. So based on this, you can calculate the average speed. And if you know the mean speed of the wind, then definitely you can calculate the value of C, that is called scale index. The scale index is calculated by the equation number 2. The condition is that if you know the mean speed of the wind speed, then based on this, you can calculate the scale index, and the scale index C is nothing but 1.1128 VM, where VM is the mean of the wind speed of a particular site. And this VM is calculated based on the historical data of a particular site of a wind speed. So by using this equation, you can forecast the probability of the wind speed of a particular site. Now, wind power generation, The equation number 3 gives the output power of a wind turbine. So before that, I would like to clarify some 3 category of the wind speed: cut-in speed, cut-out speed, and rated speed. The cut-in speed is the minimum speed required to generate the power. The cut-out speed is the maximum speed beyond which the wind turbine cannot generate the power, and the rated speed, the speed of the wind at which it will give the rated power of the wind turbine. So based on this, if your available wind speed is between 0 and cut-in speed, if your available wind speed is between the 0 and cut-in speed, then your output power is 0. If your available wind speed is between the cut-in speed and rated speed, then output power of the wind turbine is given by nothing but P rated multiplied by V available minus VCI divided by VR minus VCI. Similarly, if your wind speed is in the range of the V rated and V cutout speed, then definitely you will get the rated power. And if your wind speed is above the cutout speed, then definitely you have to stop the wind turbine, because due to some centrifugal force it may damage the wind turbine. So that is why you cannot generate the wind power when the wind speed is beyond the cutout speed. So based on this, you can calculate the output power of the wind turbine. So in this way, we can forecast the probability of the wind speed, and as well as if you know the wind speed, then you can also calculate the wind power generation by using equation number 3. So this is about the modeling of the our wind power generation. Now solar power generation modeling. As we know that the irradiation level of the solar is also varying from morning to evening, and due to this varying nature, it is uncertain to predict the exactly or accurate the solar power generation, and that is why a probability density function is used to forecast the solar irradiation level. And for that, a beta probability density function used for modeling the uncertainty of the solar power generations, and that is given by the equation number 4. So irradiation level of a particular site can be forecasted by equation using number 4, where gamma into alpha plus beta is divided by gamma alpha gamma beta si raised to alpha minus 1 into 1 minus si raised to beta minus 1, where alpha and beta is a calculated value. Let us see how it can be calculated. And si is the solar irradiation level, and it is the range of the solar irradiation level between the 0 to 1. Okay. So to calculate the alpha and beta, we must know the mean value of the solar irradiations and standard deviation at a particular site. If you know the, and that also can be calculated by using the historical data of the solar irradiation level at a particular site, and based on it you can calculate the alpha and beta. So here mu is the mean value of the solar irradiations, and sigma square is the standard deviations of our solar irradiations. And if you know the mu and sigma, then definitely you can calculate the alpha and beta by using equation number 5 and 6. So if you know the alpha and beta, then definitely you can calculate by using equation number 4 the probability of the solar irradiation level of a particular site. Okay, so this is the probability or the forecasting value of the solar irradiation level. Now what is the amount of the solar power generation? and that is the given by the equation number 7. So equation number 7 indicates the amount of the power generation of a solar power. So eta PV is the efficiency of the PV panel, SPV is the area of the PV panel, and SI is the radiation level of that particular area. So based on these, you can calculate the solar power generation of a particular site. So this is about the forecasting of the probability of the solar radiation level as well as the solar power generation of the PPV. Now PV aggregator modeling. This is very important because our main focus on this PV. So what is PV aggregator? So PV aggregator is a separate entity in electricity market, and main task of it is to manage the charging of a battery of PEVs. Okay, the main task of this is aggregator is the to manage the charging of battery of PEVs. It provides the information of PEVs to be charged based on the historical data for each hour. So what information this aggregator will provide? It provides the information of PEVs to be charged based on the historical data for each hours. This PV aggregator has to deal certain uncertainties, that is the initial stage or the initial state of charge of each battery, the arrival time for charging, and the departure time of vehicle after fully being charged. So these three are uncertain things that PV aggregator has to forecast. And based on the historical data, we can forecast it. So PV aggregator provides these three forecasted parameters, and the error in these forecasted parameters are usually defined using uniform random and normal probability density functions. The other name of normal probability density distribution function is Gaussian probability functions or Gaussian distribution functions. So here the initial state of charge is forecasted using uniform random, and the arrival time and departure time of electrical vehicle is forecasted by using normal probability distribution functions, or we can say Gaussian distribution functions. So we can say that PV aggregator can be modeled as a large scale storage device having uncertain stochastic capacity and energy. Okay, because the number of PEVs are connected to the charging stations, and this charging station is the battery, means we are charging the battery of the electrical vehicles, and this is the uncertain things. Okay, and that is why if the large number of PEVs are connected to the charging stations over a certain geographical area, then if you consider this certain geographical area, then you can consider it is a large scale storage device. And this large scale storage device is having uncertain stochastic capacity, means it's the stochastic in nature, not certain, uncertain stochastic capacity and energy. So let us see how can we model these things, or how can we forecast the initial state of charge of battery, arrival time and departure time of the plug-in electrical vehicle. So here the equation number 8 to 12 govern the charging and discharging of the battery of a EV. Let's see equation number 8 first. If you know the charging efficiency and the discharging efficiency of a battery, And if you know the state of charge of a battery at a particular time t, then by equation number 8, you can calculate the state of charge at t plus 1 time of a PEV. Okay, so equation number 8 is nothing but state of charge at time t plus 1 is nothing but state of charge of PEV at time t plus charging power multiplied by time multiplied by charging efficiency minus discharging power multiplied by time divided by discharging efficiency. See here the efficiency in numerator, here the efficiency denominator, definitely because it is a charging, it is a discharging. So it is opposite, that is why it is written like that. Equation number 9, 10, 11 are the inequality constraint of this charging and discharging process. The meaning is that equation number 9 says that the state of charge PV is always less than the maximum state of charge of PV. Definitely, otherwise there is no meaning of charging if it is a maximum value. So it should be, it must be always equal or less than the its maximum value. The equation number 10 indicates the charging power should be lie within the this range, that is the 0 to maximum. Equation number 11 similarly indicates the discharging power from the battery, it should be the range decided, that is the between the 0 and maximum of the discharging. Now equation number 12 is very important. The equation, the capital T is nothing but the total time of charging, means at time t the SOC level of the battery must be equal to the SOC of the maximum, means it should be fully charged at the end. The battery of the vehicle must be fully charged. So in our objective function, in our optimization problem, we have to consider this constraint. Otherwise what happens? If you not put this constraint, that is the equality constraint or the equation number 12, then it may be happen that after certain times or after certain hour, your battery is not getting fully charged. So that is the lose of our motto or objectives. Our main objective is that to charge the battery by coordinating the V2G and U2V operation. Okay. So this equation number 8 to 12 are the governing equations of the state of charge or the charging and discharging of the our battery of the EV or the electrical vehicle. Now forecasting of the our state of charge and arrival time and departure time. The forecasting of the our initial SOC, F of SOC PEV 0 is the forecasting of the probability of the forecasting of the, that is the initial SOC or the residual power of the battery, that is given by the equation number 2, and that is nothing but uniform random. And it is given by the equation number 13, that is 1 upon V minus A, where A is 0, B is equal to 1. And the value of the our X is between the A and similarly, the arrival time of the forecasted arrival time is governed by the equation number 14. This is the standard Gaussian probability distribution equations that I have written here. The only the change is the arrival time and departure time. The equation number 15 is also a standard Gaussian distribution equation, that is the probability to calculate the probability using this normal distribution function. So the equation number 14 and 15 indicates the identify the probability of the arrival time and the departure time by using this normal probability density functions. So here we can forecast this initial SOC, arrival time and departure time. So these are the our three main parameters of the PV aggregator modeling. Now let us see objective functions. How can we model these in our objective functions, and which cost that we can calculate? So here there are three costs are there. GC means generation cost, RC means rescheduling cost, and PVCC means PV charging cost. So our main aim is to minimize the generation cost, means our thermal generation. The aim is to minimize the rescheduling cost, and our aim is also to minimize the PV charging cost. Okay, and this is throughout the day, and that is why we have summed this cost T is equal to 1 to 24 hours. Means we have to minimize this cost. See, the generation is continuously generating the power throughout the day. The rescheduling also required to throughout the day, and charging is also, PEV charging is also required to throughout the day. So that is why we have considered this optimized objective function to optimize over a day by considering the 24 hours. It is also called a multi-period optimization. If you have considered only single time, that is called the single time optimization or objective function. So when you consider the throughout the day or 24 hours, then it is called the multi-period optimization, or here we can see, we can say that it is nothing but multi-period OPF, optimal power flow, by considering various probability of the renewable energy resources, probability of the plug-in electrical vehicles, and considering the various constraints also. So the problem is stochastic in nature, and that is why we have to consider the Monte Carlo simulation also in this case. Or we can say that when this kind of stochastic nature is considered, then we have to generate the number of samples, large number of samples, or the scenarios of the uncertain variables. So here uncertain variables are that wind power generation, solar power generations, and PEV charging factors. Which factors? Initial SOC, arrival time, and departure times. So by considering all these uncertain things, we have to generate the number of samples of these uncertain things, and then we have to, it may be a 10,000, it may be a 50,000. If you want to give some accurate result, definitely you have to generate the more and more number of samples. So for that, we will apply the scenario reduction techniques. I will discuss in later on what is the scenario reduction techniques and how can we handle this technique and what is the importance and significance of this technique in this our study. So here we simultaneously minimize or optimize the three costs. First one is generation cost, that is given by the equation number 17, where AG, BG, and CG are the cost coefficient, and PGT is the amount of power generation at particular time or at particular hour. And G is equal to 1 to NG. NG is nothing but number of generators. So here we calculate the generation cost by considering the various cost coefficient and all the generators. Okay, so equation number 17 gives our the generation cost of our conventional generation or the thermal generations. Equation number 18 gives the rescheduling cost. Rescheduling means depending upon the congestion in the network, ISO instructs the GenCos or the generating companies to reschedule their generation so that this congestion can be relieved. Or any parameters, if violated, then definitely to recover this parameter within the limit, ISO always instruct the GenCos that you have to reschedule your generation, and this rescheduling of generation, and for that ISO has to pay additional cost to the GenCos. because after marketing clear process, it is clear that you have to generate this much of amount of generate power. And then after, if the any constraint, why the network constraint violates, then definitely you have to pay additional cost to the GenCos for rescheduling purpose. And this rescheduling cost is given by the equation number 18, where C of delta PGT is the amount rescheduling cost coefficient, and delta PGT is the amount of rescheduling at particular time T. So the rescheduling cost is given by the equation number 18. Equation number 19 gives the PV charging cost. See, here we have considered the both the charging and discharging. Why it is so? Because in our problem, we have to coordinate the V2G and G2V operations. Means G2V, in during G2V operations, PEV will draw the power from the grid, and during V2G operations, the vehicle will supply the some certain amount of the power to the grid during the peak hours or as and when it requires. So let's see how it is possible. So here EPVT is the charging cost. Here we have charging and discharging cost. We have taken the same cost. In some cases it may be a different, but here we have considered the charging and discharging cost is equal. So this charging PEV cost, charging cost is for the all the number of PEVs, means how many number of PEVs is connected, that we have to consider. So these are the three costs, and we have to minimize this cost by considering the uncertainty of the RES and by considering the uncertainty of the PEV, this plug-in electrical vehicles, or the number of the plug-in electric vehicles to be connected to the charging stations. Okay, so there are certain constraints that we have to consider, or these are the generally optimal power flow constraints, but we have modified, we have to modify constraints according to the our system, modified systems. See, as you know that in load flow studies, it is given that, PG minus PD is equal to P injected. That is the equality constraint. It is a conventional or the our load flow constraint that is that we have considered, but here I have modified certain these. PG is there, but here wind power generation and solar power generation is also there, so we have to consider this is as a generation. Similarly, load as a we have to consider as a load. There is a minus sign, and discharging power of PEV at particular time, that is also considered as a generation, and charging power at particular time T is also considered as a load, and that is equal to nothing but injected power, and this injected power is nothing but the amount of line flow of the line, all the line. Suppose we have considered here, we have considered IEEE 39 bus system, and 39 bus system, for example, it is a 46 line or 47 line. So injected power is nothing but the summation of the line flow of the online. That is nothing but injected power. See, here we have not considered any reactive power supplied by the wind or solar, and that is why we have not modified this inequality constraint of the our conventional reactive power balance constraint, and that is why it is written like that, the QGT minus QDT is nothing but injected reactive powers. But this is the multi-period power balance constraint. Means at each hour, you have to balance this constraint. That is why the time period is written at for each and every variable. Okay. So this is the inequality constraint that we have to consider at each hour. Now certain inequality constraints that we have to also take care. So the inequality constraint is that whatever the generation you generate by the conventional generation, that also should be lie within the its max and min limit. As you know that the every generator has a maximum limit, every generator has a minimum limit. So you have to keep this limit. You have to always watch that whether this generation is within limit or not. Okay, So active power limit and reactive power limit is there that we have to constrain. Another constraint is line flow. As you know that once the transmission line is installed, the power carrying capacity is fixed. You cannot modify the power carrying capacity except some fax devices or another any methodology. So the power carrying capacity of each transmission line is fixed, and definitely we have to take care about this power carrying capacity, and it should be always then less than its maximum limit. Okay. And similarly, the bus voltage, particularly I'm talking about the load bus. So you have to take care the load bus limit also, load bus voltage limit also, it should be the within limit. So these are the inequality constraint that we have to consider whenever we model our problem. Okay. Now scenario reduction techniques. This is a very important thing. Why we have to need to require this scenario reduction? Because in our problem is stochastic problem, not a deterministic. Okay. So in stochastic programming, we have to generate the number of samples, and this number of samples now suppose 15,000 samples we have generated. So for it is not possible to evaluate the our problem for each and every problems, each and every samples. It takes a very huge time to evaluate the our problems, and that is why we have to reduce this sample or scenario by some scenario reduction techniques. So here in our case, the one of the best techniques, that is the K means clustering algorithm. It is the one of the scenario reduction techniques that we have applied here, and it will reduce the time, and it will also not affect the scenario. So let us see how can we reduce this scenario. So in stochastic programming, the computation time is decreased by the reducing the number of scenario generated. And in this study, the reduction in scenario generation is carried out by using the k-means clustering algorithm. So what this k-means clustering algorithm will do? Okay, how it works? Let's see. This algorithm will arrange the original wind output power, solar output power, arrival time, departure time, and initial LOC into cluster according to the matches. It makes cluster. Okay. Let us see how it will make. And the centroid of each cluster is determined by calculating the average value of each parameter in each cluster. And then you have to determine the centroid by averaging the each parameters. Okay. For example, I have 50,000 samples, and from these 50,000 samples, I want to reduce 50 samples or 50 scenarios. Then out of 50,000 samples, I have to cluster these 50,000 samples into 50 clusters. And I have to calculate the centroid of each cluster, and I have to determine the cluster in a such a way that no corner of the sample is untouched or unleft. Okay. So I will discuss you how it is possible and how it works. It's an iterative algorithm. This K means clustering algorithm is an iterative algorithm, and by iterative procedure, it will determine the cluster, its centroid, its average value, and it covers all the corner of the samples. No corner is left. Okay. So this is the iterative procedure of K means clustering algorithm. So here there are certain steps. Let us discuss these steps. So first step is to select the number of requisite clusters. How many clusters you requisite? For example, here in this case, our requisite cluster is 50 and we have generated 50,000 samples. So it is not possible to evaluate the for each and every sample, otherwise it takes very huge time. So what we'll do, we reduce the our samples into the clusters. So first we have to decide the number of cluster required. So the first step is select the number of requisite clusters. The second step is choose the initial centroid of all cluster arbitrarily. You have to choose the arbitrarily the centroid of each cluster. And now after these two steps, we have to apply the while loop with some conditions. So the step three is the while loop, and the condition is the stopping of this while loop is the variation in the cluster structures turn into small. Means after certain iteration of this while loop, when the variation in the cluster structures turns into small, then this will end your while loop or the break the while loop. So the first step or the step number four that is in the while loop is the first is the compute the space among every original scenario and every cluster centroid. You have to consider the means compute the space every original scenario and every clusters. The step number five is allocate each original scenario to the neighboring cluster based on the space calculations in four. And step number six is compute the new cluster centroid using the original scenarios allocated to every clusters. See, I will not go into detail. If you want to read about the literature regarding the k-means clustering algorithm, you can search on the Google. You will get the lot of literatures. And even in MATLAB programming, one command is there, k-means clustering. So by using this k-means clustering, you can also calculate the, in MATLAB also, you can also calculate the, or you can also reduce the scenario by using this command. If you see the help command of the MATLAB, so you just write the k-means, you will get all the details on all these this iterative algorithm with some mathematics. So I will not go in details, but the some highlights of the k-means algorithm that I would like to discuss here. Okay, so here the arrival time, departure time, and an initial value of SOC can be clusterized by using this k-means clustering algorithm. Now this is our algorithm or flowchart of our problem, that how can we formulate our problem and how can we solve our problem. So that can be studied by these flowcharts. First of all, we have to collect the various data of our system that is considered. So first the system data. In this case, we have considered the IEEE 39 bus system, that is the England system, New England system. That is the system of the geographical of the England. Load profile that we have arbitrarily considered, that is from morning to evening, the amount of the load on the system. Wind and solar output power data, this wind and solar output power data that we have taken from some reference paper or the literature, and PEV data. PEV data that we have assumed that number of PEVs, and we have considered the various cases without PEV, then 5000 PEV, 10,000 PEV, 20,000 PEV to up to 50,000 PEVs. Now what ISO will do first? So ISO will first do the power, get the power at the cheapest rate after market clearing process without considering the constraint. So what the ISO will do, ISO will purchase the power through power exchange, through trading, and it gets the power at the cheaper rates, but at that time they have not considered any network constraint. Okay, then it runs the load flow. So when the ISO will run the load flow after getting the power from the power exchange. So ISO will find that certain parameters violates its limits. means certain line gets congested, and so ISO has to instruct the GenCos to reschedule their cost, reschedule their generations, and ISO has to pay the rescheduling cost. And then after, we have to minimize the generation cost, rescheduling cost. First case is without PEV. This is our base case that we have considered without PEV. And then after, we will consider the number of PEVs. PEVs of the 10,000 PEVs, 20,000 PEVs, 30,000 PEVs, and 50,000 PEVs. So then after considering this number of PEVs, we will minimize the objective function. And if all the PEVs considered, then we will compare the result of the generation cost, scheduling cost, PEV charging cost with different PEV case. So here we have tested our result on standard IEEE 30 bus system. We have taken the wind and solar data from the references or the standard paper. And the only thing that we have considered that is the number of PEVs for various cases. Okay, now let's see what are the test system and data that we have considered, and I will also discuss the certain assumptions regarding the PEVs. Okay. So the proposed congestion management or the impact, quantifying impact of the PEVs on the power system operation is analyzed on modified IEEE 39 bus system. Why it is modified? Because standard system is that, but along with the standard system, we installed wind power generation and solar power generations, and that is why the system is modified. Here we have taken the mean wind speed, so mean solar radiation, standard deviations of the wind speed and the standard deviation of the solar radiations, some references, and that is the reference number 3. I will show you the reference at the last. It is assumed that the 200 megawatt capacity of wind farm is installed on bus number 14. Here we have considered 39 bus system. So it is assumed that the 200 megawatt capacity of wind farm is installed on bus number 14, and similarly the 200 megawatt capacity of a solar park is also installed at bus number 22, and the PEVs are connected at bus number 5, 10 and 70 respectively. The detailed number of PEVs I will show in later slide, but here we have assumed that the PEVs are connected on bus number 5, 10 and 70. And 50,000 samples are generated using Gaussian probability density function for arrival time, departure time, and uniform random function for initial value of battery of PEVs. Means here 50,000 samples of the arrival time, departure time, and initial value of the battery or the SOC of the battery is generated using the normal distribution functions, or the by considering these Gaussian distribution functions. The evaluation times for these 50,000 samples is quite large, and hence to reduce it, K means clustering algorithm is applied to generate 50 samples of arrival time, departure time, and initial value of battery of PEVs. See, another thing is that here we have considered the our study over the day. So the tariff for over the day is different, for the peak load tariff is different, off peak load tariff is different. Okay, and flat rate tariff is different. So here we have considered the three tariff, that is the flat rate tariff, peak rate tariff, and off peak rate, peak period tariff. And that is the nothing but flat rate tariff is $20 per megawatt hours. Peak and off peak are also the $25 and $50 megawatt hours. These are also taken the reference, also references. So here, see, this is the graph, three dimensional graph of our initial value of SOC, departure time, and arrival times. So this is not a 50,000 samples, but for the sake of understanding, I have generated this graph by generating the some samples, and I have reduced the possibilities. The blue is encircle dots are the all the possibilities, and red is dark encircle is the reduce possibilities by applying the k-means clustering algorithm. The same thing is also possible if I generate the more number, then it gets congested. You cannot identify the reduce and all possibilities. And that is why I have generated by some simple or the thousands or 5,000 samples. Okay. So this is the three-dimensional original and reduced scenario of the by applying the k-means clustering algorithm. Now, number of vehicles for different buses. So as we have told that the vehicles are connected bus number 5, 10 and 17. So we have considered 5 cases. First case is of 10,000 vehicle, second case of 20,000 vehicle, third case of 30,000 vehicle, fourth case of 40,000 vehicles and fifth case is 50,000 vehicles. And these 10,000 to 50,000 vehicles are also more classified by the bus numbers, means on bus number 5, on bus number 10, on bus number 7, how many vehicles are connected for the charging purpose, that is also considered. Okay, so by considering the this amount of vehicle, we have carried out the our analysis and we get the very optimistic results by considering this analysis. This is the mean value of the hourly solar radiations, and means irradiation level, solar radiation level of a particular site for a morning to evening. That is the mean value. Similarly, this is the mean value of the wind speed over a day. Here we can say that the wind speed also varies over the day from morning to evening. It is the mean value of that, and from this mean value we can calculate the forecasting value and the output power of the wind generation. This is the load profile over a day. It is also three-dimensional graphs, means on each every bus at which time how much load is there. Okay, the x-axis is the load, y-axis is the bus number, and here we have 39 buses and here is a time. Now it is very important thing, this is the assumptions. By assuming these assumptions, we have carried out our analysis. The first assumption is that the arrival time of PEV for charging is at 5 p.m. and is considered as normally distributed with 1 hour standard deviation. See, the logic behind to consider this is that during office hours, means morning 9 to 5 p.m. we can assume that the EV are not free to for charging purpose. After office hours they go to for charging purpose, and here we have considered the slow charging, and it is assumed that this EV is connected to charging purpose for at least 12 to 14 hours. Okay, the departure time of PEV after being fully charged of battery is at 9 a.m. next day morning and is also considered normally distributed with 1 hour standard deviations. Means standard deviation 1 hours means that 5 p.m. is that some EV is coming for 5 p.m., some EV is for 6 p.m., some EV is 7 p.m., some is even EV is coming for charging for 4 p.m. also. So you have to generate some samples accordingly, and according to the probability, you get the probability results. The third one is the initial value of SOC of battery is randomly distributed and it is between 0 to 12 kilowatt. See, before that I would like to consider this sixth number. The maximum capacity of battery is PEV is 25 kilowatt. It is assumed that the maximum capacity of a battery of each PEV is 25 kilowatt. and it is initial value of is assume that is 0 to 12 kilowatt means the 50% to 0 volt. Okay. Here the connected PV or the plug-in electrical vehicle can be utilized for both G2V and V2G operations. This is another assumption. Means it is not like that you are drawing the power from the grid. Whenever grid required, you can also supply the power from the your battery to the grid. Definitely your battery is very small, that is 25 kilowatt, but if you consider the collective parallel operation of this EV and the by considering the number of vehicles, that is 10,000, 20,000, definitely a certain amount of power you can supply to the grid also. Okay. And the energy charge for the charging and discharging of battery are same for both G2V and V2G mode of operations. So by assuming these assumptions, we have carried out our simulation or the optimization of our objective functions. Now let us see what is market clearing power. The market clearing power, as you know that the objective of market clearing power is that the market clearing process is carried out to get the power at cheaper rate to meet the hourly demand of the next day. And this process takes place in day ahead market. See, there are many types of market, day ahead markets, hour ahead markets, and real time markets. So here we are talking the day ahead markets. So the market clearing is nothing but it is a process to carry out the power at the cheapest rate, and that is to meet the hourly demand of the next day. So for that, the GENCO submit their bid block powers and price bid block to the ISO. And distribution company submits their predicted load demand for next day to ISO. So DISCOM also submit their predicted load demand. GENCO also submit their bid block power. That is the power in certain bid block and also price bid. And based on this, ISO clear the market based on the available bid block, price block, and next day demand without considering the operational constraint of the power system. And after market clearing process, ISO intimates the GENCOs to supply the power according to the clearing the process at each hours. So after marketing process, GENCO has to supply the power according to the market clearing process at each hours. So we can this process can be materialized in mathematical way also. So let us see how can we materialize this mathematically. So let A and B are the vectors of block bid and price bid respectively. We have two vectors. Vector A is the block bid and vector B is the price bid. Capital A and capital B. And small b is the number of the block bid. And suppose NG is the number of generator available for supplying the required power. So this can be the cheapest power at each hour can be obtained by using equation number 26. See, A is the vector of the block bid, B is the vector of the price bid, small b is the number of block, T is the number of hours, and G is the number of generators. But only the condition is that your amount of power generation always equal or greater than demand block that is submitted by the distribution companies. Okay. So by optimizing, if you know the block bid, if you know the price bid, if you know the demand bid, then By considering this constraint, you can calculate the market clearing power at each hour. So by considering this, we can calculate the market clearing power. So after calculating this, let us consider this bid block power. In IEEE 39 bus system, there are 10 generators. Okay. So each generator has a block. Suppose generator number one has a 3 blocks, and 3 block is divided in this way. First block is 350 megawatt, second block is 40 megawatt, and third block is 290 megawatt. Similarly, each generator has 3 different block of generate amount of power. Okay, this is the bid block power. This table indicates the bid block powers. Similarly, this is the price bid block, means each generating companies gives the block of price. Respectively, by considering this respectively, generator block. For example, for generator of block number one, the amount of power generated is 350, and for that the price is $30.33. Okay, so this is the price bid that we have considered. This is the block bid that we have considered, and by considering this price bid, block bid, and our load profile that we have I have seen in previous slide, load profile, and by considering this load profile, price bid, and block bid, we get the market clearing power at each hour by each generator. This is the 30 number bus to 39 bus are the 10 buses. These are the generating bus, and these generating bus will provide the power after clearing the market process, that is from our 13 to 24 hours. Okay, why we have considered this hour 13 starting, I will clarify it. Because as we know that our PV is coming for charging at 5 p.m. and that is the for the sake of simplification for calculations, we have started our time hours from the 13 hours. Okay, all the 24 hours are considered here. For the sake of simplicity, for the sake of calculations, we have considered this. Our starting hour is afternoon 1 hour. So this market clearing process, after market clearing process, we get the this amount of generation, and by considering the this amount of generations, when we run the load flow, then after load flow we get the this result. Means certain at for a particular hour, the certain line get congested. For example, load level 1, the line number 3 get congested. Load level 2, the line number 3 also get congested. Similarly, at each and every level, the number of line get congested. Now the congested means that the line flow limit violates. As we know that I have told you that at the time of installation, after installation, the power flow carrying capacity is fixed. You cannot modify the power flow capacity without any improving methodologies. Here it is assumed that there is no improving methodologies applied. So this limit violates. So now what ISO will do? ISO will instruct the GENCOs to reschedule their generation. And after rescheduling, this line will be relieved from the congestion. So this is about the how many line get congested after market clearing process and after running the load flow. And then after, ISO will instruct the GENCOs to reschedule their generation cost. And after optimizations or after running this our problem, optimized our problem, we get the various results. See, there are various optimization techniques are available in literature. I will not go into detail which optimization techniques is used, but here I have modeled these problems in GAMS. GAMS means General Algebraic Modeling System. This is the one of the powerful tool which is used to optimize of large scale complex non-linear problem. Definitely various solvers are available in the tool for various kind of problem, whether it is a linear problem, whether it is a non-linear problem, whether it is a mixed integer linear problem, whether it is a mixed integer non-linear problem, whether it is a quadratic problems. So various commercial solvers are available in these tools, that is the GAMS, and the name is the GAMS, General Algebraic Modeling System. And I have modeled this problem in that environment, means the GAMS environment, and it's a very powerful optimization tool. No doubt, various optimizations, meta heuristic techniques are available in literature. One can also use this meta heuristic technique also. But particularly in these problems, we have applied, we have formulated our problem in these GAMS. I will show you the website also, and one of the good books for that I will show you at the end of this session. So now let us discuss the various costs that we got after optimization, after formulating our problem in the GAMS environment. So here, see, the first one is when the vehicle is zero, no vehicle is charging, at that time we get the generation cost, rescheduling cost. Definitely the vehicle is not, that the charging cost is zero, and that is the total cost. Similarly, for 10,000 vehicles, for 20,000 vehicles, for 30,000 vehicles, for 40,000 vehicles, and for 50,000 vehicles, we get the generation cost, rescheduling cost, and PV charging cost. Okay, as you know that as the number of vehicle increasing, the generation cost reduces. Okay, the rescheduling cost increases and PV charging cost increases. The main thing is that as the number of PEVs increases, the generation cost reduces. Why it is so? I will show you why it is so. Because here we have coordinated the V2G and G2V operation, vehicle to grid and grid to vehicle, and that is why in PEV charging cost equation we have considered the charging and discharging both the equations. So here we have assumed that the PEV get plug in for a 12 to 16 hours period, and that is why these PEV plug in PEV or the number of PEVs can be treated as a small storage unit, and this small storage unit can supply to the grid whenever during the peak hours or whenever the grid requires. Okay, and we have also put the one conditions: at the time of the next day morning, the vehicle must be get charged, fully charged. Okay, so by considering this constraint, we get these results. And due to V2G and G2V operation and coordinating among the V2G and G2V operations, here as the number of PEV get connected or the get plug in to at the charging stations, so the generation cost reduces. This is the means we have to pay less the generation cost if the PEVs get connected for a particular hour. Okay, so this is the one of the important result that we get, means by increasing the number of PEV get connected, we get the reduce the generation cost. See, if we see this generation reduction in the generation cost in terms of percentage change, so we can also discuss this how much percentage generation cost reduce. So we can say that if we consider the zero is the reference value when the no PEV is connected, so this is our reference value, and with respect to this reference value, it is seen that from 0 to 70.34% reduction in the generation cost. Okay, means as you increase the number of PEVs, your generation cost can be reduced up to 70%. means ISO has to pay certain amount to the GenCos, and that is can be 70% up to. So this is also one of the important conclusion or important investigations of our problem formulations. The comparison between the number of vehicles and PV charging costs. See, here the first second column is the number of PEVs. Third column is the PEV charging cost per day. Third one is the change in the number of PEV vehicle and change in PEV charging cost. See here, the 10,000 vehicle is the reference cost. So when we increase the 10,000 to 20,000, means we have increased the number of vehicle 100%. So when we increase our vehicle to 100%, but our charging cost only increased by 79%. So compared to 100%, definitely the charging cost should be increased 100% here, but not. It is reduced. Why reduced? Because due to the G2V and V2G operation. When V2G operation is there, then the PV aggregator get rebate in terms of discount. And when G2V operation, the PV aggregate has to pay. Okay, so that is why we can say that in the last row, if the number of PEVs increased by 400%, the increase in the charging cost is only 305%. So this is another important investigations during our study, that it is beneficial to connect the number of PEVs on the grid, but the condition is that with the certain assumptions. This is the load on the power system due to the PEV connection or plug-in. So as you know that we have considered the various number of PEVs, 10,000 to up to 50,000. See, during the peak hours 19 to 21 or 18 to 21, it's a considered as a discharging mode, and rest of the mode it is considered as a charging mode. So we can say that during peak hours, these PV aggregator will supply the certain amount of the load to the grid. So this can be treated as a small storage unit for the grid. Similarly, this is the PEV charging cost per hour for different PEVs. So this is our discharging cost that we get in terms of rebate, and this is our charging cost. Similarly, this is the total loss per day for number of PEVs. So we can say that 0 PEVs, 10,000 PEVs, 20,000 PEVs, 30,000 PEVs, 40,000 and 50,000. And this is a total load loss per day. So as you see that as the number of PEV increases, the total loss also reduces with the increasing the number of PEVs. So this is also a favorable investigations for us. Now similarly, if we consider this in terms of percentage, the percentage change in total power generation or total power loss is nothing but the power loss can be reduced up to 6.8%. As we increase the number of PEVs, the total power loss can be reduced up to 6.8%. And similarly, total power generation per day can be reduced by the up to 9.43%. So these are the very important investigations, our problem that we have considered. But the thing is that we have formulated this problem by considering these certain assumptions, and these assumptions, if we consider these assumptions, then and then we can this kind of results. Now I will show you that is website of the, then we will discuss the some summary of this our problems. This screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Visible.
Okay, so this is the website for general algebraic modeling system. Definitely it's a licensed version, but demo version you can download from this download. But thing is that in demo version, a small problem can be formulated. For large and complex problem, you have to purchase the license. And for the academic purpose, the license cost is very nominal compared to the commercial purpose. So if you are interested to model your problem in GAMS environment, so it's a very powerful tool, and it gives the very good result and in less time compared to the another meta-heuristic techniques. So this is the, you can refer this website for that. And if you are interested, then you can also download the some demo version. A tutorial is also given in the demo version. So you can practice how to model your problem into GAMS environment. A tutorial is also given in the demo version. Even documentation also, a very good information is given. So this is about the platform that I have used. The another thing is the book that I have referred. It's a very good book, Power System Optimization Modeling in GAMS. It's a book published by the Springer. This screen is visible, this book?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in this Power System Optimization Modeling in GAMS, various chapters are there. So initially in chapter first, two chapters, basic information, how to problem model the general problem of the mathematical problem. And then after various electrical engineering problems, such as the power system problems, such as power plant dispatching, dynamic economic dispatch, unit commitment. So this kind of problems is described very nicely, and some programming is also given in this book. So if you feel, if you find this book, definitely it's important those who are interested in power system optimization, multi-period optimal fire flow, energy storage system, power system observability, transmission operation and planning, energy system integrations. So very good chapters are there. It's a very good book published by the Springer. So if you are interested, then you can visit this, or you can purchase also this book. Okay. So let's conclude our session, the final summary. So this study addressed the congestion management of power system having uncertain renewable resources and plug-in electrical vehicles. So what we have considered? We have considered the uncertain wind power system, uncertain solar power system, uncertain PEVs, and market clearing process. And based on this, we find that the certain line gets congested. And how can we relieve this congestion, and how can we minimize our objective functions by considering this uncertainty? The objective function cost is minimized by minimizing the rescheduling cost, generation cost, and PV charging cost. The main important thing is that the benefits are maximized by utilizing the available PEVs in V2G and or G2V mode. Here we have seen the some benefits in terms of the reduction in the loss, reduction in the generation cost, reduction in the PEV charging cost. So these benefits can also be maximized by coordinating the or optimized coordinating the V2G and G2V mode operations. And that is why hence it is more economical to operate the PEVs in either load or generation mode interchangeably instead of independent operation load. And that is why on here it is not it economical. It is economical to operate the PV as the both load as well as generation, not only low load. If you consider only load, then it is not benefit for you. But if you consider load and generation, then definitely it is beneficial. And so we can, in last, we can say that the generation mode of PVs fulfills the additional requirements of the power system and the work as a small storage unit. So here we can see that the PV aggregator can be treated as a small storage unit for a grid, or whenever grid requires, particularly in peak hours. So this small storage unit can be treated as, can be supplied a certain amount of power as per the requirement of the grids. Okay, these are the references that we have referred for the various datas. Okay, for wind power data, solar power data, met power data, that is IEEE 39 bus data, that we have taken from these references. Okay, so thank you very much. Now if you have any queries, so you can ask.
Prajapati sir, one query is there.
Yes sir.
Nice presentation. Say the assumptions we have not taken in the study, if it is incorporated in a practical condition, then it will go to a realistic implement. Say for an example, suppose say we take an assumption that charging and discharging cost is same. Now even the discharging can be given at that your vehicle is supply in a V2G mode, while it is very needed, it is very essential, just like a peak load period. Vehicle battery might have an adverse effect while it is supplying a base load period, and it is not meant for, it is not actually mean for to supply the base load period. So जो लोग इससे आगे आपके स्टडी से आगे इंस्पायर होकर करना चाहेंगे, अगर मेरे ख्याल से वो प्रैक्टिकल कंडीशंस अगर वो सब इंकॉर्पोरेट करेंगे तो एक बड़ी वास्तविकता की ओर जा सकेंगे. Is it so, sir?
Yes, you are right, sir. You are right, because we have it's not a practical conditions. Practical condition might be a different, and our purpose of the study is that if we consider like this, yeah, definitely there are certain limitations of the discharging and certain technologies. That is, you have to consider the loss of the converter, inverter, and certain harmonics also. But if the slow charging purpose, if you consider the slow charging of vehicle, if you get connected your plug-in vehicle for certain amount of, that is a 14 to 16 hours, definitely we get the kind of results.
Fine, sir. And even the candidate can justify the differentiation between slow charging at home and slow charging at the parking place, because that will be also a different scenario. One is set by the user itself, by bounded by some ex government norms, and second is bounded by a charging station establisher person who is also bounded by certain Y norms of the government.
Sir, when you are charging at home, then you cannot generate a virtual storage unit. Okay, our purpose is to generate the virtual storage unit and to supply the grid for a certain particular peak hours. And for that, you have to compulsory go to the charging stations and you have to plug in your vehicle for a certain period of time, and then it is possible.
Fine. Nice presentation. Fine.
Sir, in continuation of that Kashyap questions, so if we connect, let's say to the grid, then will the AGC will not affect it, automatic generation control?
No, sir. Here you see that AGC automatic. Yeah, AGC is not definitely. Suppose we are rooftop. Solar rooftop is also connected on the each and every house. AGC is not affected, sir. Similarly, this is the reduction only that you have seen the 70% of amount when you connect the 50,000 vehicles. So it depends upon the number of vehicles to be connected.
Exactly, I'm asking. If the number of vehicles will be increasing, then definitely that setup will be disturbed.
Yes, sir. It may be disturbed up to certain amount, but it may be possible to apply some corrective measure also, na, sir. If we get some benefit, definitely to get some benefit, we have to apply some certain measurement also. Even AGC can also be affected during the faulty situation also, even overloading conditions also. So for that, remedy is there, sir.
Exactly, remedies is there, but what I want to say that part will be now, a good research area, that whenever this nonlinear would be increasing, even storage will be, we can say that become a nonlinear, then definitely the setup of the well-established grid, AGC control will be definitely affected, and that is, nowadays it is a good research area, just for I'm giving the information to.
Definitely, it may affect, sir. It may affect, but for that you have to, we have to provide some corrective measure for that, sir.
Exactly. Thank you.
Now, any participant want to ask question?
Sir, I am audible, sir.
Yes.
Is there any for proper performance of this DG or renewable energy based grid?
Please, your voice is not clear. Okay, please tell.
Sir, for suitable performance, to obtain the appropriate performance of the grid connected renewable energy sources, we have to optimize the location of the renewable energy sources. Like, is it necessary to place electric vehicle charging station in a suitable location? Is it necessary? Or we can place anywhere the electric charging vehicle station, sir?
No. I have skipped these things. Definitely place affect the results. But here in this case, I have considered this bus number where the lightly load is there, or where renewable resources is placed where the load is high and the PEVs are connected where the lightly load is there. Definitely, if you change the load location, definitely it affects the results. You have to find out the optimal location for RES as well as PEVs by considering the various optimal location techniques.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thanks.
Any other?
Sir, GAMS is suitable for determining the optimal location? GAMS?
Definitely, yes. GAMS is suitable, optimal locations. But the thing is that it is you have to first to learn the how to model your problem into GAM environments.
Okay.
And I have recommend one book or suggest one book, and that is very good book, in which each problem is defined very clearly by giving some programming also. So if you try that particular program and if you model, then definitely you will learn lots.
Okay, thank you, sir.
In view of the previous discussion, sir, सवाल किसने पूछा था पूछा नहीं वही हम लोग डिस्कस कर रहे थे कि आपको assumptions को बढ़ा के और strong भी काम इस पे और आगे काम कर सकते हो like that say EV can be thought as a reactive power support also. So it can be thought of vehicles operation in four quadrant and ancillary service operation by EV, reactive power support, all those things can be added at appropriate time.
Definitely, sir, lots of potentials are there in this area. One can explore many area in this, particularly PEVs, because in India right now, the PEVs are not in trend, but now day by day, the PEVs are coming in trending. So definitely it affects our grid also. So how can we protect our grids and how can we minimize our losses, even congestions, even violation of the various parameters. So definitely lots of potentials are there for in this area. And we can also explore the various assumptions and conditions also.
Fine, sir. Great.
Any other participant?
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. V.K. Prajapati, sir, for informative session by discussing the line congestion problems and with the V2G and G2V and analysis shown regarding that and various optimization technique discussed. Also the GAMS, GEMS optimization for linear and non-linear problems. On behalf of organization team of FDP, I am very much thankful to you, sir, as deliver the expert talk over here. And I think all the participants have enjoyed the session, and it is also very helpful to the participants for further research in this area. So thanking you, sir, for sharing your knowledge to us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for patiently listening my talks and for inviting me on this platform. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tomorrow, as per the schedule, all the participants need to connect. Okay. So
thank you.
Hope
thank
you,
you
enjoy the session.
Yes. Yes.
Thank
yes,
you
thank
all.
Thank you, Dr. V.K. Prajapati sir and team of GEC Patan. A wonderful sessions are going on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So here we are ending the session now.
Okay, thank you.